Greetings, unsettled souls! Welcome to the Correct Views. My theme song was cued wrong. Welcome to the Correct Views, friends. Theme song or not, Sam I. Beating Angie during political commentary. For the Media Speaks, as well as, you can find my work separate from the Correct Views and the Media Speaks on the Conservative Daily Post and Blasting News. So I do remember that, and I'm going to get right into blasting the news here with information about how we have learned, not, people say we've learned virtually nothing from Fukushima. No, we've learned some things from Fukushima. We've learned how to hide dangers in such a way that we can pawn just about anything off on the stupid public. That's what we have learned. Let's take a real good look at exactly what it is that caused Fukushima. And I'm not talking about the tidal wave. Okay, the tidal wave definitely created three of the four meltdowns, melt-throughs and melt-outs that we saw on the video that we saw the horrible aftermath of. However, people lose track of the fact that it was an earthquake that first triggered the disaster. That means that an earthquake can cause a meltdown, because the earthquake cut down the cooling system for one of the reactors that melted down. Okay. So what would an earthquake do if it was to hit California? Wouldn't that be the same thing? Now, you want to add the tidal wave motion of this in? Depends how the earthquake hits in California. That could also be a factor. Are there dams near the nuclear power plant? Because if there are, you could get the same effect of a tidal wave upon a cooling system, pretty much as the tidal wave itself gave. I mean, it doesn't need to be a tidal wave to be damaging to the main cooling system of the plant. And depending on how long it takes them to get to the plant, even if it's not a meltdown, a lot of the problems that you are going to be seeing in terms of poisoning would be in effect, depending on how long it was until the fuel was cooled and how much damage was done to the reactor and the containment vessel. Well, this is express.co.uk. Quake alert, fears of big one coming as U.S. hit by 8 tremors within 1 hour. Okay, this isn't small. We saw this kind of thing leading up to the Japanese earthquake. The U.S. Geological Survey revealed that a 5.7 magnitude earthquake, followed by a series of aftershocks, struck on Wednesday morning near Nevada's border with California. The largest tremor hit around 12:22 a.m. local time, and it was closely followed by 7 further quakes with magnitudes 5.6 or less. And again, the other one was a 5.7, so do remember that a 6 to a 7 is 10 times as bad with an order of magnitude. Now there are fears that a magnitude 7 or above big one could strike the earthquake-prone region. Emergency services are said to be addressing the impact of the latest of the spate of quakes. Nice wording there. I like that. Terrified social media users went online to spread the news about the hits. Let me tell you, the main thing to be alarmed about here isn't that the quakes are hitting where so many people live. So many people live where they know quakes hit. They take that risk. Okay, I'm in Ohio. You have the tornado risk. My wife is from Florida. You have the hurricane risk. No matter where you go, you've got some people whining about some great risk. I mean, at that point, you don't live in fear of such things. However, when your fellow man has seen fit to put a nuclear bomb in the form of a power plant in your earthquake zone, okay, well, now you've got more to worry about than whether or not your house is still standing, which is significant. Now you have to worry about things like whether or not you're still able to stand after breathing and God only knows what. It means you get to wonder whether or not you get to be hooked up to cancer machines with tubes coming out of you in all directions, clinging to life because of what you breathed in near the power plant that you lived in. And it's the same in Ohio. We have the nuclear Bessie, the Bessie nuclear power plant here in Ohio, not too far from me. It's not close enough that I don't think their routine releases are going to get me, but if they were to go red, things could be bad very quickly. Tony Lewis wrote that three major earthquakes in Nevada, possible precursors for something big. Amy added, oh, I'm up now. This is the last earthquake shock. Rock my bed and my window blind. See, they're worrying about what's right in front of them, what they can see. Okay, they can see the debris. They can see the rubble. They can see things like that. So that bothers them. And when they see things like cancer, when they see things like people looking like sunken shells of themselves, that bothers them. But they're not bothered by the very things that are causing this to be the case, that are causing this to be a risk. And that is what could very easily lead to their downfall. They're worrying about what is seen instead of what isn't seen. If you survive the earthquake, and your loved ones survive the earthquake, then the worst of it, at that point, is behind you. If you survive a nuclear disaster, or a meltdown, or a massive release of nuclear power, then what you have done is postponed what is going to be a very long and agonizing series of health problems. I mean, that's as real as you can be. Let's also remember that it can take one tiny, like we're talking a micro speck here, of a hot element to get inside of your lungs or inside of your body, just one. And it will do its job to give you cancer sometimes throughout the course of your life. So I hope that people have listened and heeded the warning and will do something, particularly if you're hearing this upon the West Coast. All right, friends, independent.co.uk, anti-surveillance clothing unveiled to combat facial recognition technology. I'm absolutely thrilled about this, because I'll tell you what. I've heard the argument the terrorists are going to use is terrorists are going to use everything. Okay, they're going to use the cell phone, they're going to use the computer. We have a right to not be spied upon by the government. And you may say, well, the government is trying to catch terrorists. And I believe to a large degree they are. I think at the highest levels of government, some people may shield terrorists for the good of their own agenda. But by and large, I think our nation probably tries to fight terrorism, yes. They also try to fight the American people. Sometimes with a lot more success than they fight the terrorists with. Remember the Patriot Act? Okay, I wasn't against the Patriot Act when it first started because it was meant to be temporary, and they tried to keep it forever. Thankfully, it's gone. And they tried to use terrorism as a threat or a walkway towards busting people in America who otherwise would not have been under surveillance due to the rights given to them via the Fourth Amendment, the right to be left alone, if you will. Now, you could argue that there is more good being done because they caught this, what? Because they caught somebody who was smoking weed in his own house? Because they caught somebody that was taking cigarettes across state lines? Those are unconstitutional laws to begin with. What, we're supposed to spend hundreds of thousands of our tax dollars for something like the Patriot Act enforcement? Pardon me. And then we're going to go ahead and find out that it's being used to catch somebody who was hauling cigarettes. It was used to rope somebody in for a speeding ticket that they shouldn't have got because the cop was being too invasive anyway. Is that what we're spending money on? Okay, I'm all in favor of something like this. Hyperface involves applying unique patterns to clothes which appear as thousands of faces. I love this. Are we seeing this? This is the kind of thing that makes you realize that America isn't completely, I'm going to go screen share for you guys, isn't completely neutered. We're not a nation of eunuchs yet. I've been told by someone that people wouldn't wear this. I certainly would wear it. An artist has unveiled a clothing line designed to confuse facial recognition technology and hand privacy back to internet users. Adam Harvey, who has created various projects relating to mass surveillance at his headquarters in Berlin, said he intends to fight back against the now widespread commercial use of facial recognition with a new textile strategy called Hyperface. And we've covered some of these before, but this is the most clever one. By applying seemingly random patterns of clothing, these appear as thousands of recognizable faces during analysis and can overwhelm computer systems. Amazon recently started using facial recognition technology at checkouts in their physical store, while Facebook and Apple also use it to tag photos for users. While Harvey told the Chaos Communications Congress, it says, that last year he was using the Hyperface project created in partnership with Hyphen Labs, we should definitely own stock in them if they're helping us, to overload an algorithm with what it wants, oversaturating an area with faces to divert the gaze of the computer. I like this. He said the projects are motivated by concerns about how computer vision will be used to extract knowledge out of the cooperation or consent of the individual, adding that he felt facial recognition technology poses a significant threat to privacy. Amen. God bless this person. Mr. Harvey, the person who should be blessed, was already introduced CD Dazzle, an avant-garde form of makeup and hairstyling, which could be used to confuse facial recognition. He views Hyperface as an extension of this earlier project. He also designated Stealthware, a collection of counter-surveillance clothes, which he said helped wearers hide from thermal imaging and drones. This is very good. In December, a Russian company launched a controversial program called Find Face, which can identify a stranger among 300 million Twitter users in less than 1 second, despite a warning that the app violated the website's rules. Well, it's time that we start making it so that it's a little bit hard for them to violate our rights. And I personally am thrilled to see something like this come about, because if we don't stay vigilant, the machines that we use every day, like I'm talking to you right now through, you know what's going to happen? They're going to be used against us in the way that the Patriot Act was used against us. And they're going to go out of their way to diminish our rights in any way that's possible. Believe that. We see it with the Second Amendment. We've seen it with the First Amendment. We're seeing it with the Fourth Amendment. If this matters to you, then share this video. Tell people that I'm out here. And donate to the show at thecorrectviews@hotmail.com, do it through PayPal. I also want to say this is normally where I have an ad, but I'm selling ad space. So instead, I'm going to sit here and talk to you for a minute about how I'd like for you to be an advertiser. How do you do that? Go to thecorrectviews@hotmail.com and tell me that you want to be an advertiser. You've heard about the work I've done with Sticker Junkie, Change Transportation, Watch the Skies by D. Allen Ross, Mike McLaughlin. Do you want to be advertised? You want to be on the show? You're watching it. Somebody else is going to be watching it. Let me know when you want to do it, how you want to do it. Moving on, we've got Trump conducts his own sting operation to ensnare intelligence briefers and says he caught them leaking. No, he doesn't mean paying. Dailymail.co.uk. This is Trump making sure... That was an ad. That wasn't the end of the story. Christelle's like ready to pounce. She's like, I got the camera. There is a lot of us that say that Trump went too far in the way that he condemned Snowden and the things that he was saying in regards to Snowden needing to be prosecuted. Well, it might be that Trump has got to make sure that there isn't a Snowden simply by catching leakers leaking false information. For instance, if I've got two people here, and I know that one of them are leaking stories that I'm going to cover. They're giving it to other commentators. They're giving them my angle, and I don't know which one it is. So I tell them that I'm going to do an article that I'm not going to do at all. And I wait to see who writes it and who may have contacted my people. Because I can weed people out that way. You can see who has lied to you that way. That is the kind of technique that Trump is using here, which will likely prevent very many leakers from being in the administration. Will some leaks happen during the course of his four-year presidency? I'm sure it will. Positive. But I don't think it's going to be the constant stream that we are seeing currently. And that could be for better or worse. I mean, we have to hope that Trump is as honest with what he's doing in government as he says that he would be. President-elect Donald Trump, after growing suspicious that intelligence officials were leaking news about their classified briefings with him, says he concluded he conducted a sting operation to try and prove top spies were behind the leaks. Trump revealed the extraordinary scheme to try and entrap the senior spies in a furious press conference, which he suggested the intelligence community had been behind salacious and totally unproven allegations against him. And they have been. I think it's pretty sad when intelligence reports get leaked out to the press. First of all, it's illegal. There are classified and certified meetings and reports, Trump said during a press conference at Trump Tower, his first since getting elected. Then he revealed the details of the stealthy sting that he says he conducted on the nation's senior spooks. I'll tell you what does happen. I have many meetings with intelligence. Every time that I meet, people are reading about it, Trump has complained, possibly referencing reports on his classified briefings, which he has chosen not to receive daily. Which may or may not be a good idea. You can see one reason he would be doing that would be to prevent leaks. But that something could sneak up on him, although in this day and age, I'm sure they could get a hold of him right away. Somebody's leaking them out, Trump said, after inveighing against leaks generally. So I said, maybe it's my office. Maybe my office, because I've got a lot of people. Maybe it's that. What I said is, I won't tell anyone. I'm going to have a meeting, and I won't tell anybody about my meeting with intelligence, Trump continued. He even shielded one of his closest aides from word of the meeting. Nobody knew, not even Rona, my executive assistant for years. She didn't know. I didn't tell her. Nobody knew, Trump continued, drawing laughter from collected family members and staff. Having set the trap, Trump says the word leaked anyway. The meeting was held, they left, and immediately the word got out that I had a meeting. So I don't want that. It's very unfair to the country. It's very unfair to our country what's happening, he said. So there you go. Let's remember what Eric Holder was mad about. Let's remember that the information that was leaked, that Eric Holder went after Fox News and took Fox News' freedom of the press away and spied on Fox News reporters. Let us do well to remember that this was something that had already been leaked. Trump is going to bust the leakers in a rather different way. He's just going to set them up with information that he knows when it gets out, he knows who did it. Russia's authorities, this is interesting, I'm going to read this real quick. However, there were other aspects of Trump's engagement with the Russian authorities. One which had borne fruit of them was to exploit Trump's personal obsessions and sexual perversion. That's the lie that they tried to put on Trump. And it's interesting. Here's what my first reaction to this was before moving on. My initial reaction to this was, if Trump had done the golden shower routine, that's pretty twisted. I'm not going to lie. Not something I'm into. I think his wife is beautiful, and I have probably thought impure thoughts about her. But I have not ever dreamed of having her give me a golden shower. But I'll say this. If it had been true, does it affect me? if he has weird sexual fetishes, it doesn't affect me to the level that the would-be president was putting email servers in bathrooms that had to do with national security. And again, I was happy to hear that it wasn't true, because I didn't want it to be. It was a little, like I said, it was a little twisted. So I'm glad that it ended up being a lie. We all know now the reliability of BuzzFeed. Thomas Barrett, it says, Chief of Media Relations for the Director of National Intelligence, declined to comment on the substance of Trump's alleged sting. I'm sorry, we have nothing to offer on this matter, he told the DailyMail.com. As President-elect, Trump is entitled to a daily briefing on the crown jewels of the intelligence community. The briefings typically are conducted by high-level intelligence officers. On Friday, he got a briefing that included James Clapper, the Director of National Intelligence, and other top intelligence officials. At his Wednesday press conference, he went after the intelligence community as being behind the leak of a dirty dossier of material that we just talked about. So, friends, do well to remember that there are people that love to slander other people. Okay? There are those that love it. Now, you could argue, hey, Sam, didn't you do that with Pizzagate? Go back and look at what I said about Pizzagate, particularly the article that I read. I was somebody saying that there were so many nefarious deeds and so many creepy, perverted people around Podesta. We'd already known about the spirit cleansing, Satanism crap. So it wasn't that far of a stretch to believe that they were also tied in to what we know through the Lolita Express was a pedophile ring. Was the pizza shop to blame? I did not think it was weird to look into the pizza shop. I don't think that's bad reporting. I'm sorry, I don't. When a lot of shady people constantly show up at your door, government is allowed to knock on your door and ask whether or not you're selling crack. However, when shady people show up on someone else's door, you're not allowed to knock on the door and ask any questions because he's John Podesta. You're supposed to look at him as God. My ass. Friends, why has the White House suddenly released a strategy for dealing with a threat of catastrophic meteor impact? This is Michael Snyder. Just an interesting story. End of the American dream. Does the White House know something that the rest of us do not? As the Obama administration draws to a close, Mr. Snyder writes, the White House has suddenly released a major document that details multi-pronged strategies for dealing with the threat of catastrophic meteor impact. Multi-pronged strategy, huh? Most of us remember movies like Deep Impact and Armageddon that attempted to depict what such a crisis would be like, but up until fairly recently, the U.S. government has never seemed to take this kind of threat seriously. I think they have through NASA to some degree. They've been trying to watch for them. They haven't been spending the money that needs to, because we're all too busy bombing each other, of course. One of the things that have changed, it says, a new report is just the latest in a series of measures that the government has taken over the past couple of years to help prepare us for incoming meteors and asteroids. The following is an excerpt from a recent Gizmodo article. Listen to this. Concern over an apocalyptic asteroid strike has risen all the way to the top. The White House released a document this week detailing a strategy for national near-Earth object, NEO, preparedness. Morgan Freeman would no doubt be proud, although, honestly, the nation might have more pressing apocalypse concerns that's closer to home. Last year brought renewed interest in handling humanity-ending impact events, it says, after a 2014 audit showed that NASA had crudy neo-preparedness systems, the agency founded a new planetary defense, that's what I was talking about, coordination office. And it was made last year to detect all of our potentially nasty neo-neighbors, and it quickly escalated into action, running preparedness drills with the Fed. So a lot of this might just be from the new office opening up. It might not be doom and gloom. I'm not just going to try to clickbait here. But NASA continues to assure us that no threat is imminent. and this is why I spend energy on non-existent crisis. Well, I can tell you why they do that. Because it's also said, and I don't know if Michael Snyder is aware of this, and I do love his writing, so this isn't a stab. Hello, Mr. Snyder. I don't know if Snyder knows that, let's say, we know about 30 of these, or 100 of these, that are looming around us. That doesn't necessarily mean that we can see all of the sky around us. And that is a major concern. And because we know that there are things that we can't see till the last minute, like the meteor that went blasting into Russia that made a hole in the earth, a massive, looks like a nuclear bomb hole in the earth. It came out of nowhere, nobody knew it was coming at all. And if something of significant size was to take us by surprise, a lot of these drills could be held for that scenario. So that's why you tune into the correct views, I'm sure. However, he's right here. This is worth knowing. If you want to read the 25-page document, he's got it linked here on the site. It's also linked to Prison Planet. And you can read it for yourself. The document was put together by the Interagency Working Group for Detecting and Mitigating the Impact of Earthbound Near-Earth Object. There's a name. And it outlines 7 key objectives that the authors believe are important. So here's the nuts and bolts of it, friends. Enhance NEO detection, tracking, and characterization capabilities. Develop methods for NEO deflection and disruption. Improve modeling predictions and information integration. That means predicting what space and gravity is going to do near the planet and the moon. That could be tricky. Develop emergency procedures for NEO impact scenarios. That would be helpful. Establish NEO impact response for and recovery procedures. Leverage and support international cooperation. And what do you mean? Countries work together? Unheard of. You must be racist. Establish coordination and communications protocols and thresholds for taking action. Without a doubt, he writes, we definitely need to enhance our detection abilities. Just the other day, a very large asteroid barely missed us, and they had only covered it 2 days earlier. Early Monday morning, while the East Coast was pouring coffee, dropping kids off at school, and cursing in traffic, a space rock as big as a 10-story building slipped past Earth. The asteroid, dubbed 2017 AG-13, was discovered on Saturday at the University of Arizona's Catalina Sky Survey, according to the email from SLOOH, S-L-O-O-H, a company that broadcasts live news of space. So, not since America has dodged Hillary Clinton's presidency has the world so dodged a major catastrophe that I can think of. Says we are very fortunate this time, but the truth is that our planet crosses paths with other giant space rocks on a very regular basis. In February, the later object dubbed 2016 WF9, was detected by NASA, again, only after, in late November, and was left scientists scratching their heads. They have described the celestial rock as a cross between an asteroid and a comet. It's in the middle of a 0.9-year orbit between Jupiter and Earth, and will approach us on February the 25th, that's really soon, flying by a distance of 32 million miles from the planet, which is nothing in terms of gravity when you're talking about something that size. Currently, approximately 10,000 major near-Earth objects have been identified by scientists. That's only 10% of them are more than 1 kilometer in size. So, I mean, there could be a lot of them that we do not see. Just imagine the kind of devastation that an asteroid or meteor hits the Atlantic Ocean and a tsunami hundreds of feet tall would be racing towards the coast of North America, South America, Africa, and Europe. It says millions upon millions of people would die. Something ISIS would be happy about. This is something that scientists have studied. It says, according to a study conducted by the Uni of Cali in Santa Cruz, if a giant meteor did strike the Atlantic Ocean, we could possibly see a tsunami waves 400 feet tall slam into the east coast of the United States. 400 feet, that's bigger than the Obama lie about our good economy. If an asteroid crashes into the Earth, it is likely to splash down somewhere in the oceans that cover 70% of the planet's surface. That makes sense. 7 and 10 for you Lady Gaga fans. huge tsunami waves spreading out from the impact site, like the ripples of a rock tossed into the pond, would inundate, heavily populated coastal areas. A computer simulation of an asteroid impact tsunami developed by scientists at the Uni of Cali in Santa Cruz show waves as high as 400 feet sweeping into the Atlantic coast of the United States. So you could pretty much say goodbye, New York City, okay? Depending on where the meteor strikes, we could potentially see New York, Boston, Philly, Baltimore, Washington, D.C., Charleston, Miami, and countless other major coastal cities all wiped out in a single day. 39% of Americans live in the country that directly borders the shoreline. So there you go, friends. Heed the warning. Again, what are you going to do about it? Well, it would be prudent to support organizations and science grant seekers who are looking for these things. I mean, it doesn't take a lot of money. When you hear me do these stories, you know what? Pick up the phone and donate like $1. Donate like $5. I mean, I'm as broke as anybody else. I get it, but, you know, give something. If the story seems like it mattered to you, donate to the people that are trying to make it happen. They're not paying me anything. If you want to pay me anything, you can do it at thecorrectviews@hotmail.com. And that, friends, does bring us to the DUMBDEE of the day. Again, we cover the dumbest story on any given month, and we do it via the Dunce Cap of the Month Awards show at the end of the month, the beginning of each month. We do the DUMBDEE of the day every day. Here's our You Are an Idiot song. Again, if you want to go ahead and donate to the show, you can do so at thecorrectviews@hotmail.com. Alright, so who is an idiot? Who is an idiot? You're not going to believe this, friends. The deity of Jesus Christ pretty much hangs on the fact that they believe that he is God incarnate. I am a Christian, that is what I believe. However, a Koran verse denying Jesus was the Son of God was sung in a Scottish cathedral. Way to go, Scotland. Maybe they'll let you sing about how Jesus Christ is Savior of the world in a madrasa. Okay, I highly doubt it. Look at this BS. Oh, the video has been removed by the user. It's on Breitbart. You can look it up. I'm sure it's still online. The passage from the Quran that denies one of the central tenets of the Christian faith was sung aloud at a cathedral service in Scotland. It's like spitting in the face of King David. The passage from Surah 19, which specifically denies that Jesus was the Son of God and says he could not be worshipped, was sung during the Eucharist service at St. Mary's Episcopal Cathedral in Glasgow to mark the Feast of the Epiphany. Now, you know, the Episcopalian Church, depending on which faction it is, has not necessarily been a friend of the historic Christian faith. So we're not very surprised there. A video of the recital was posted on YouTube showing a girl singing the passage in a typical Islamic style, that is to say, cat wailing. Sounds like Beyonce. It narrates the Islamic account of the birth of Jesus, which includes the claim that Mary was ashamed after giving birth, and the infant Christ miraculously spoke from the cradle, something not found in Christian scripture. That's because it has no basis in reality, so it's not put in scripture. It's not historical facts, so it's not in scripture. It's real freaking easy. No, the infant Christ probably did not speak from the cradle. If he had, then the people in the city would have already been like, oh, we can easily believe he's God because he was speaking from the cradle. No, they didn't say that. Instead, they tried to stone him when he said that he was God. Therefore, there's a really good chance, Skippy, that he wasn't speaking from the cradle. Mary was ashamed of him. Mary was not ashamed of him. Joseph was mildly ashamed of her until he found out what had happened through the visit of an angel. She then concludes by singing verse 35, which states in translation, "It befitteth not the majesty of Allah that he should take unto himself a son." And then verse 36, which has the infant Jesus saying, "And lo, Allah is my Lord and your God, your Lord. So worship him, that is the right path." and the cathedral, which is why they get the DUMBDEE of the day, praised the reading in a Facebook post calling it a wonderful event. However, retired Army Bishop Michael Nazir Ali strongly condemned it, saying it was especially inappropriate for the Feast of the Epiphany, which celebrates the revelation of the Christ as the Son of God. So again, there is an Arab man standing up clearly for Christ, which is good. He needs to be praised for that. Christian Today quotes him as saying the authorities of the Scottish Episcopal Church could immediately repudiate this ill-advised invitation, and they should. Christians know that their fellow Christians believe, and this can include reading the Quran for themselves, whether in the original or in translation. This is not, however, the same thing as having it read in church in the context of public worship, he added. It is particularly insensitive to have the passage read in church on the Feast of the Epiphany when we celebrate not only Christ's manifestation to the Gentiles, that is, non-Jews, but also his baptism and divine declaration, "You are my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased." Again, a lot of people are going to say, Sam, lighten up. There is more than one way to God. Well, you know what? Maybe there isn't. It might sound or good and wishy-washy and feel good and touchy-feely to go ahead and say that all paths lead to God. Christ said he was the only way to God. So if you're a Christian, and you certainly don't have to be, I'm pretty libertarian here, if you're a Christian and you have found that the things in history line up to the things in Christianity like I have, and great minds like Lee Strobel and Hank Hanegraaff have, well then you have to realize that there isn't more than one way to God. Now, does God talk about saving those that are not Christians? It seems as though he does. But he's talking about it in terms of respecting those who had never heard the truth. Someone living in the bush somewhere that never hears the name of Jesus Christ is not going to go to hell for not knowing who Jesus Christ was. A newborn infant is not going to go to hell for sins that he didn't commit. But those are exceptions. If you have willfully stood in Christ's church and denied that he is God, then why are you in Christ's church? I'm not saying that you need to believe anything, but you do at least need to show a modicum of respect. And I'm just waiting for the day that radical Islam, or any Islam, invites us to go in and sing Silent Night about birth of the Savior on Christmas. Or maybe we should do it during Ramadan. Just a thought. Friends, you're listening to The Correct Views. Sam I.B. DeGangi signing out, reminding you once again that you can donate at thecorrectviews@hotmail.com through PayPal. And reminding you as well to think about advertising on the show. Make sure you hit share. Make sure you hit subscribe. All of that helps me immensely. And thank you, friends, for listening. I genuinely mean it. Thank you.